the business. Welcome back to another episode, another installment of Day One Radio, right here on ablradio.com. That's Art Beats and Lyrics Radio, to be exact. Make sure you download the very free, very accessible smartphone app for your iPhone and Android devices. And also make sure you check out the entire Day One Radio catalog in your iTunes podcast section and at dayoneradio.com. My name is Maurice Garland. I'm one of your gracious co-hosts. And to my right, I have
the world famous BP, Brandon LSK. Happy belated birthday, brother.
Oh, man, appreciate it, man. You know, I'm in the 3-6 mafia now, man.
No doubt. Had a good time hanging out this weekend, man. Food was great.
Yeah, man. You know, we did it Mississippi fish fry style, man.
For sure. I had to take it to go plate and everything. It was whoever fried that fish, made them egg rolls and them cakes, was on point.
For sure.
Most definitely, man. And we also want to thank y'all for coming out this past Wednesday to Hip Hop Trivia, where we discuss beef. This week, it's 1996, so we talking everything from the Fugees, the Jay-Z's debut, the Tupac Death Row albums, the whole nine. So it's going to be fun. People are going to be arguing.
Yeah, man. And it's like, you know, that quiet is cut. That's kind of what I've been enjoying the most. You know what I'm saying? It's like, wow, people are really, really engaged in this. You know what I'm saying? Any other time, I probably would have been annoyed. Like, God damn, man, y'all arguing again? But it shows you that people are really caring about this event that we bring in, man. So we appreciate everybody that's been coming up through Slice Atlanta week in, week out, man.
Exactly. So make sure y'all come. Every Wednesday, we there, 8 p.m. to 11 p.m. We got drink specials and $50 gift cards to the winner, and we will have extra prizes as time goes on, you know. So, but this week, man, we in the last week of May, bro, and this is one of them ones. I don't get excited for too many albums,
right?
But as y'all hear, we are, as we are always here, we in the mix. Corner Peachtree and MLK, we got the choppers downstairs. But My little bro, man, Mistah FAB, straight out of Oakland, California. His album he's been working on for a while, Son of a Pimp Part 2, drops on the 27th. If you ain't been paying attention, it's everybody's on that joint. Kendrick, Crooked Eye, 2 Chainz, I Am Sue, Raekwon. You know, the list goes on and on. He has Keisha Cole, some of everybody on that joint, man. And he's doing his media run in New York, man. So we rarely do call-ins, but this is a special occasion, man. So we had the little homie call in and do a great interview, man. So hopefully you guys enjoy it. We're about to go into a quick break, and we'll be right back with Fabby Davis Jr., a.k.a. Mr. Fab.
Yo, this is Ray Murray from Organized Noise. You're listening to Day One Radio on ablradio.com.
So, man, we're going to jump all over the place a little bit, man. We got to give an intro for those who don't know. I feel like even though quietly you haven't gone nowhere, you haven't been as much in the public eye as you normally are. So, Mr. Fab from Oakland, California, back for you dropped a gang of projects in between, but this is the first legit barcode album in what, 5 years? Six? No, more than that.
Shit, maybe a little bit more than that. Maybe like what Bay Dextrin came out in 07?
Yeah.
07-08. So somewhere around there, about 8 years.
Yeah, so Son of a Pimp 2. Got everybody in the world on it, of course. Called in a lot of favors, got a lot of people respect you in the game, man. Walk us through a little bit of that process of taking 5 years, man, to really fine tune an album and throwing away songs and coming back to songs and recording new stuff and all that.
Man, well, just being in a position, man, to be able to take off some time and then come back is definitely a blessing, because there are a lot of people who, if they take 6 months off, the world will forget them. So fortunately, I've been able to, you know, I took a little time off in between things to cultivate this project a little bit better. As we say, you know, the project took about 3-4 years, maybe even more, to kind of complete. in the exact precision that I wanted it to be done. So what I was able to do was go out state to state, city to city, and my affiliations and associations with the artists in different areas definitely paid off. The benefits of being a good guy and the benefits of being, for one, you know, a talented MC that people respect, and for two, just being somebody that always kept it 100, I was able to cash in a lot of favors, as well as just get people to, you know, be responsive and receptive to me presenting to them a record to get on for this project. So when you see all the collaborations and the features on this album, it's not just I got them just because I went out and paid for them, or I went out and just wanted an album featuring a crazy album featuring a lot of people. What I wanted to do was I wanted to tell my story collectively alongside the guys who I respect for the artistry, as well as alongside of the people who I feel as are folks to me in the industry, like cool homies. So that's why you see, you know, the people that you see on this project.
So did this idea actually pop up in your head 3-4 years ago to do this album, or was it something where it was like you were collecting songs and was like, you know what, man, I do have a gang of material here, let me go ahead and do something with this?
Well, this project had changed names a couple times. Like, this was supposed to be the project that I was going to give to Atlantic at the time, you know, that I was working on, or that I had projected in my mind mentally that I wanted to present to them. As time, you know, kept moving forward, I kind of was just like, all right, well, whatever situations had handled out and panned out the way that they handled, I felt as if I had some dope, decent songs, and I just didn't want to throw them away or put them on some mixtapes that I know no one would hear about, or that I wouldn't do the PR or put the work in to get the recognition of it that it deserves. So, you know, they went into the collector's box. They went into my Pandora's box. And recently I decided that I wanted to say, man, I can't keep just holding on to this music. This is some music. There's a void for a guy like me in the music industry right now, especially from an independent position. So why not be able to go put out this project, go put a little couple dollars behind it, and see what you can do, man. Even if you can generate somewhat of a buzz, you're still putting good music into the universe. And, you know, the universe respects your effort. So whatever it is that you're going to do, it's going to reciprocate your effort. If this record does a miraculous amount of numbers, cool. If it doesn't, cool. I'm not looking to make, you know, no tumultuous amount of money off this project. What I'm looking to do is put some good music back in the game. From not only Oakland, California, but from a hip-hop perspective and a standpoint in general. Just putting some good music that's just not based off how much money you got, how many women that you've slept with, and how many, you know, your accolades. It's not about advertising accolades with this project. It's about actually making some good music conceptually and tying it in alongside some of the industry's top-tier artists.
Now, I know, you know, years ago when before your mom passed away, that you had promised her that you wouldn't put out this project until the situation was right, to where it would be received correctly, to where you could put the proper, you know, you were in the right mental space to put it out. Do you feel like that's come together now, that everything, all the stars have aligned for it?
Most definitely. It's all about the aligning of the stars and the proper fruition of what it was that I told my mother. So to see that actually be able in position financially, I'm able to fund it the way that I want to fund it. I'm able to put some form of backing behind it and not think twice or not worry if I'm going to go, you know, I'm going to overdo it or underdo it. I'm able to put the time and the energy into it. Creatively, my mind state is back in artistry mode, meaning I'm willing to deal with the rigorous task of going city to city and doing interviews and, you know, dealing with fans and doing things like that, man. You have to be in the right mind state to do that. You can't go in there with an aggravated mind state or with a different temperament when you're dealing with. I'm mentally ready for this project, man. I'm mentally ready to get back into this. You know what I mean? I just feel the energy is right. And the time is right, man. The time is right for me to put out some music and let the world hear my voice and my thoughts and opinions of certain issues that's going on.
For sure. Now, we got to catch you up with the people. Now, the last time that you were all over TV, all over the blogs, all over everything, other than the battle with Arsenal was, you know, the hypey movement and the whole tail end of that. So for those who haven't, you know, that don't follow you on Instagram or whatnot, like, what have you been doing the last few years? You know, we know you've been writing. You dropped a couple freestyle projects, the dope era clothing. So catch people up on everything.
Well, like you said, man, the clothing line has definitely flooded the streets of where I'm from. It's called the Dope Era. My brother and my friend and I, we created this little crazy clothing line that rekindles memories of the 80s and the 90s through fashion. We flooded the streets. That's definitely been picking up. I've been throwing crazy shows. Like once a month, I bring well-known artists to the Bay Area, to the city of Oakland. You know, I've brought everybody from Boosie to Plies to Keisha Cole to Jeremiah and so on and so forth. So the show promoting, the songwriting, like you alluded to, being able to be a part of big records like Loyal for Chris Brown and Headband for B.O.B. and several Too Short records and some local guys that have had like big records and regional success, to be a part of that. Some of the marketing and streaming behind those things. A heavy sports advocate, so I've been, you know, an avid Warriors fan.
Yeah, we're going to get into that.
In a mix of dwelling and dealing with that team and watching our success and doing some form of like a celebrity, like sports analyst for the Golden State Warriors, man. So that's been that. And then most of all, what I'm most proud about is my community work. The community effort is great, man. The philanthropy within the community about helping rebuild the community, the construction and re-education of those who feel the need to give back, on the front line, on a daily basis with dealing with the youth and trying to create some form of change within the youth by showing them that there are people outside of their immediate families that care about their well-being, and we are some of those people, investing in the youth, which is one of the greatest investments because, you know, tomorrow they are tomorrow's future leaders. And besides that, just enjoying my life, man. Chilling with my daughter, building and
shout out to Liberty.
Yeah, most definitely shout out to her, man, because she's the apple of my eye. And just cultivating the best father-daughter relationship that I can have with her for the maturation of her success and whatever it is that she wants to do in life, and being totally supportive to her as my mother was to I. So, you know, those are some of the things that's going on with me.
Definitely, definitely.
Have you, like, how is, like, you know, like, being a father, like, affected, I guess, like, your music? I mean, of course it's going to affect your grind. I mean, you're going to go even harder to keep, you know, food in the baby mouth. But, you know, saying just as an artist, how would you say fatherhood has affected, you know, the music that you make?
Creatively, it definitely makes you be more mindful of the music that you put into the universe, because you have to understand that message can easily be misinterpreted by your daughter into thinking certain other things, and you don't want to promote certain things that that's not cool. Like, you know, you don't want to promote certain ignorance and negligence and things that she could pick up on, and she would think that it's formidable for, you know, for her to do. Like, it's here's a pass for you to do. Well, daddy does it. You know, I want to be a reflection as well as a symbol of change for her. So when she looks at me, like, I don't smoke, I don't drink in front of her, I don't do any of that. Not just in front of her, I don't do any of that. So if she ever picks that up, which I'm sure, you know, I hope she doesn't, but if she ever does, it won't be for me. You know, so I just try to be the change that I want and wish to see in her and see that she continues to keep moving forward. That's why with a lot of the events that we do, I always have her on the front line helping and passing out gifts for the toy giveaways, passing out gifts for the turkey giveaways, passing out turkeys for the backpacks and so on and so forth. I always have her involved so she can understand the importance of philanthropy. So I'm happy about that, man. And music-wise, I just want to put out, you know, a good message with good content and let her know that you have to be conscious of the music that you put out there, as well as I'm conscious of the music that I allow her to listen to.
Yeah. That's a big part of it, too. It's crazy, bro. Like, I don't even know if you remember, like, the first time we met was back in the Showcase magazine era with Frank and Will and K and all of them with back when you still had hair on your head. And the Nig Latin days, man, and just to see the growth, man, over time is both professionally and personally is crazy, man. Like, we all grow and hopefully get mature, but some of us don't, as you know. So it's dope, and I commend you on that, man. And I want to talk about some of the songs on the album, man. Like, I have listened to the joint, and, you know, everybody will be able to hear the album on May 27th, which is this Friday. But the All Around the World song, man, with Keisha Cole, which we'll play a little bit of, is, dude, that's like, it's a throwback, but at the same time, it's current. Like, how long did it take you to really put that whole thing together and not necessarily even getting her on the song, but just being able to write such concise lyrics that hit points that will touch people, because it's what's going on right now, and it's things that people will understand and will hit home with them. But it seems like one of them records that it'll take you a minute. You'll go back and rewrite and sit down and really be like, damn, do I want to take it all the way there?
Nah, with me, B, man, my creative process is not like that. My process is, if I'm in a studio, I hear a beat, I just go. Mm. It's like jotting down in my journal. And to actually write that song didn't take me no more than 20 minutes.
Wow.
Just because it was current events, it was what was going on, and my perspective and my opinions of how I felt about certain worldly views, as well as intermediate views about local situations at home, as well as the international views that we're dealing with. I think in America, our third world policy, we're so fast to jump into politics, which involve outside countries and things like that, when we're overlooking what's going on in our own country. When we look at the AIDS epidemic in the city of Atlanta, we look at the murder rate in the city of Chicago, we look at the impoverished homes and rate in the city of Detroit, we look at the murder rate in our own city in Oakland, California. When we still live in a United States where a man can kill a man, break a man's back in the city of Baltimore, and be freed of all charges, and there be no charges pressed. So now Freddie Gray is no different than Eric Garner, or he's no different than Mike Ferguson, and he's no different than all the countless men who have lost their lives to an injustice system that is corrupt, that is intentions to protect us, but does none of the above. So.
Pray for Paris, what they tell us, why Nigeria burn. Schools bombed overseas where kids in Syria learn. Islamic leaders being attacked for political reasons. U.S. spies kidnapped and found guilty of treason. Missiles being tested, America getting ready for war. Meanwhile, children in the ghetto gotta sleep on the floor. Cause rival gangs shooting guns with no aim at all. Police be racial profiling, trying to blame us all. And with Obama out of office, ain't no hope for the blacks. 2016, can you believe they still smoking on crack? Bigger than rap, let's take a second. Just to focus on facts, 50% of minorities in jail, and most of them black. Black lives matter, yeah right, that's just a hoax and an act. Rest in peace to the jack, hate I had to say that. Thought it was just in my city until I cut on the news. It's happening all around the world, Keisha tell them the truth. See? Oh, what you got on the blindfold? We're too busy in your bins, trying to dodge them potholes. Don't know what's going on in the streets of Chicago. Little boy killed in the alley, reason why only God knows. Young boys high, putting coke in their nostrils. It's a race of babies that hate the ladies. Must have thought it was a lie when you heard it in Pac's song. His mama strung out, and you know that his pop's gone. The preacher can't preach you, he ain't hearing the gospel. Future on his iPhone, this shit get colossal. Christians lost, acting like they really know what Christ is. World War III coming soon with ISIS. Shoe boxes full of letters, all my homies is lifers. Not just in my hood, from San Quentin to Rikers. Thought it was only in my city, till I cut on the news. It's happening all around.
I felt like there needs to be some type of artist or some type of platform where we can address these issues to the general consensus to let them know that there are still people and narrators and journalists, which rappers are, they just do it to a beat, that have to address these issues. The powers and the people and the politics they address, unfortunately nowadays, people have removed their political stance and it's been replaced with money, cars, and clothes. Mm. And a catchy radio song. And I can't knock anyone for what they choose to do and the music that they choose to make. I just felt personally at my age and what I'm bringing to the game, it's a must that I have to have some music with substance. I can't be 32, 33, 34 years old rapping about kiddie topics. Yeah. You know, where are the people that are making music for guys my age? I read in an interview when Scarface said some of the most poignant things that I've ever heard in an artist. He said, at my age, I don't have anyone in hip-hop that I can listen to and feel comfortable with the message that they're giving. Because most of these older guys are still rapping trying to chase a younger crowd. Financially, I feel that once you pass a certain level of a necessity for money, then you have to rap about what's really going on in life because it's no longer about the money anymore.
Yeah.
You know, we don't hear Jay doing songs about twerking and popping that thing. Or when Jay comes back and when Jay drops a verse, he's going to write back some music. Like he says, I don't rap about being in a project hallways. The reason being, because I'm not in a project hallways. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, So you have to understand that, and we need artists who are going to make music that's a reflection of their generation. Yeah, there are going to be songs that you catch, and it transcends towards the direction of the younger generation, and they catch wind of it, and they like it. But where are the songs that are rapping for your peers? Where's the game that you're giving for the things that you've been through? Where's your experiences being taught? Because if you're not sharing your experiences and not talking about the things that you've gone through, of what you've go through, then what's the purpose of still making music, man?
Nah, you're 100% right on that. I I've listened to that song a few times, and it feels like you damn near channeled Pac on that song, bro. Like, you can hear the influence, you can hear the inflections, everything. And that's, to me, as a Tupac fan since day one, that seems like a song, if he was still alive, that he would have made in 2016.
Like, that's what he would be talking about, man. Keisha did a hell of a job with the hook. And, like, I had sent her a hook that wasn't that one. And she was like, nah, bro, I ain't really feeling that one. I'm going to do a hook on it myself. And I was like, all right, cool. So when she came with that hook, I was like, yo, that's crazy. And I just went on. I went on. Like, one of my favorite lines on that song is, I say, a church shooter gets arrested and brought in my company.
Mm.
Oscar shot in his back and Sandra died in their custody. It's that, those two bars right there are so powerful. If you look at how that guy in the Carolinas, when he shot up the school, I mean, when he shot up that church,
yeah,
how he was brought in, it was like no problem. Then you look at a random traffic stop where a woman ended up dying and then a young man gets shot in his back for being detained at the BART station in front of hundreds of people. That's crazy to me, man. And it just goes to show you that the relevance of racism is still prevalent in the United States. And there aren't any mainstream artists or independent artists who have a pedestal and a platform to speak about these things, addressing these issues. And if they are, they're getting swept under the rug by mainstream propaganda who has no intent to raise the intellect of those that are listening to things like this. So that's why a record like that resonates not only with me, but to the listeners who actually still have a care and concern about the well-being of our people.
Yeah, because I was going to ask you that, because, I mean, of course, like, you know, you're an artist, but, you know, you obviously are still a fan and a person that knows exactly what's going on with folks. You know, I was going to ask, you know, like, did you think that, you know, there were people that really wanted to hear that? Because, I mean, some folks, they only want to listen to things that are going to make them feel good. They may not want to be reminded about, you know, what they hear in the news every day.
Well, this album was about what I wanted to do, Em. And I felt there are thousands and millions of people who feel like I feel.
Mm-hmm.
There are several voices that wish that they could voice some of the things that artists say. But unfortunately, none of their favorite artists are saying what they feel. Everything is hidden behind hidden agendas in search for a single. And radio dick riding for them to make a hit. You know, they yearn just to have a popular record so they can be popular. They're not even, they just want the money, the quick money. So what they're doing with their influence is totally not taken advantage of. And if you listen to it, it's like the story from the Bible when the man gave his three sons all, let's say, $100 a piece, whatever he gave them. You know what I'm saying? If you're familiar with that story,
yeah.
One buried it and put it up, tried to stack it. One flipped it, the other spent it. He was like, the one that put it up, he was like, dude, you wasted the money. You did nothing with it. So what worth is that to you? You know what I'm saying? The other one is like, dude, you blew it. But the one that invested in itself and flipped it, he became in good favor with his father. And that's what being in position is about. We get put in these positions to do something with our influence. And if we do nothing with it, then we wasted our position. We wasted our time at the podium that was very valuable and precious. Meanwhile, we took it away from someone who would have done something, someone who could have said something. And we didn't give that opportunity due to our selfishness, as well as we allowed our ego that's chasing something else to not look out for the greater benefit and the well-being of others. Would you kill the world to save yourself?
Right. No, that's super real. Now, you always have something to say whenever election season rolls around, particularly local politics, because that's what really matters is local politics in Oakland and in the Bay Area. And you also are very much grassroots in the mix with the community. Have you ever, or would you ever consider running for office at the crib?
Honestly, man, I think about at 40 years old, I want to run for mayor.
Okay.
I think I'd be mature at that time to be in position to do so. I think the alliances and allies that I've gained and that I will for future references gain will put me in a perfect position to be to be a well candidate, you know, a good running candidate. And I think that my policies and just my greater knowledge of wanting to do and see a better Oakland can be beneficial to the city. My passion alone, what I'll do and, you know, in years to come is learn more so about the politics and the political side of things, so I can resonate a better feeling rather than just being someone who's passionate about that position. You know, when I was younger, I would run for like class president and things like that, and I would win just based off my popularity. But I had no greater no reason to do it, but just to say I had the position. You know, like I didn't really care about the benefits of the class. What I meant by, you know, well, you go talk to the treasurer, you raise money for your class, and you go do these things for, you know, field trips and other things like that. I just did it to say I'm the president of the class, and I won because I was popular.
Gotcha.
So I would hate to do that, is what I'm saying. I would hate to run for office, win the mayor, just to say I'm mayor, but have no better expectations.
Unfortunately, for that. A lot of people do that.
Yeah, because they just do it just because they know they can win. But when you get in office, you sit there and you don't do anything. You let grants pass that can provide summer jobs for the kids.
Shout out to Libby Schaff.
Shout out to, you know, to her. You let these. So now you have a summer approaching where it's on the brink of even more murders rising, because the young guys that normally have summer jobs or some type of activities to do for the summer now have nothing to do.
Mm-hmm.
So when they go out, they're going to be outside. Now the streets are going to be flooded with a lot of young guys who have nothing to do. And negligence begets each other. And it continues to perpetuate more negligence and more violence. So the negativity will be on the rise due to lack of opportunity. Unfortunately, this is what's going on in my city, and this is what's going on in several cities around the United States. Due to lack of opportunity for the youth, they become mischievous, and that mischievous leads to delinquencies, which either costs them their life, their liberty, or their well-being.
Nah, you're right, 100%.
Once again, you're tuned in to Day One Radio, ablradio.com. We're in the building with friend of the show, Mr. Fab. You know what I'm saying? Something that you just brought up, man. You have a very, very potent song on there about talking to your brother. You know, for people that don't know, you know, Fab's brother's been, you know, locked down and everything. Like, how did you get to a place where you want to record that song, man? And tell us what the name of the song is, man.
The song is called Brother to Brother. It's the most prominent song on my album to me. My favorite song, and it's probably one of the most powerful songs that I've ever recorded, because it was so honest, and I was so passionate about what I was saying. The song was cultivated through a collection of prison letters that I have for the past 20-some years from my brother. I took several quotes and several things from, like I say, 20-plus years of collecting prison letters from my brother. And so I put it all in a song. Now, how I put it together was the artistry part, how I was able to put it like how Eminem did Stan.
Yeah.
And he wrote it from a fan point of view, like, you know what I'm saying? Like the fan was talking to him. What I did was I wrote it from the perspective that my brother was talking to me.
Not a familiar face in years. Guess they forgot to remember me. And why is Granny the only one answer? So Amy died, Mama sick and she got cancer. My best friend sleeping with my BM. My old block dying cause they beefed. I cry until the sun rise, praying for these bars to break.
Dear little brother, I'm writing to see if you got my last letter. And if you did, honestly, this my last letter. I get the point, I see you too busy and don't wanna be bothered. It's just weird how we share the same mother and father, but yet you treat me like a stranger instead of your brother. How could you hate me so much when you know that I love you? I didn't choose this life, bruh, I was forced in it. Married to the game and couldn't get a divorce in it. No prenup with me, it was all or nothing. I did all the hustling, I was tired of struggling. Got addicted to that cash money, quick cash money. Dad was on dope, he ain't had bus pass money. Moms was in the streets hoeing for gas money. I was on the corner thugging, chasing that fast money. What you wanted me to do? I never had intentions, little bruh, on leaving you. The streets was the only thing, man, that would feed me, dude. My life was hard, bruh, it wasn't easy, dude. I ain't had that type of life that you see on TV, dude. I just wasn't ready for the streets when they freed me, dude. I was chasing my past, hanging around with sleazy dudes. I was doing things a normal man wouldn't even do. I just want you to come and see me, dude. I just want you to come and see me, dude.
Got to remember me. And why is Granny the only one answer? So Amy died, Mama sick and she got cancer. My best friend sleeping with my BM. My old block dying cause they beefed. I cry until the sun rise, praying for these bars.
Every day this what I see when I awake in a cell. I spend 23 hours of the day in this cell. Gotta sleep, gotta shit, gotta pray in this cell. Gotta eat, gotta piss, gotta lay in this cell. All night, all morning, all day in this cell. Prison on lockdown, gotta stay in this cell. Think about my old bitch masturbating in this cell. Couple books help my mind elevate in this cell. So much frustration, feel my hate in this cell. No love at all, man, I'm hating this cell. Can't go nowhere, man, gotta wait in this cell. Contemplated suicide, man, by a shank in this cell. Drag queens that you probably never think was a male. Fags, punk snitches, man, be racing the tail. Undercover homos be chasing the tail. Grown men crying, getting raped in they cell. Killers on the streets, man, get faced to a male. Sally been dead a week, no escaping the smell. No letters in 5 years, lost faith in the mail. It's only so much you can take for you yell. It's only so much you can take as a male. It's only so much you can take in this hell.
Answers. Yeah. Mama sick and she got cancer. My best friend sleeping till the sunrise. Praying for these bars to break.
Dear big bruh, yeah, I got all your letters. I responded several times, just didn't have the courage to send them. And nah, I don't treat you, man, like you a stranger. But I can't lie, it's hard to bottle up all this anger. When you first came home, we had plans to change the game up. When you got out, it's like, damn, you changed up. I was thinking we could be like Baby and Slim. Me and you, we could take over the game and get the win. All I needed, man, was your patience for you to believe. But you was more interested in the streets than believing in me. So why you wonder why I'm mad and why I don't reach back? You let me down so many times doing all that. Hurt my heart to find out, man, that you was smoking on crack. Cause I was like, nah, man, my brother wouldn't do that. Hey, but you did, bro. Look up to you since a kid, bro. No matter whatever it is, you still is my big bro. But them drugs had your mind gone. And that plus blind jealousy had you looking at me like I'm wrong. Decisions you was making in the streets wasn't wise ones. And the things that you said could've jeopardized lives, bruh. You was only worried about yours, wasn't worried about mine, bruh. With you being locked up, who you think was easy to find, bruh? Your niece getting old, she about to turn 9, bruh. Daddy had AIDS, I sat and watched him die, bruh. Mama had cancer, I sat and watched her die, bruh. 12 years I waited for you, a lot of time, bruh. For you to get out and go back in due time, bruh. That's why I ain't fucking with you, I ain't wasting my time, bruh. But I love you, man, I really do. And as I get older, I feel sorry for you. But you wasn't worried about niggas trying to kill me. What will be when it will be. And this is only how I feel, I just hope you feel me. This is only how I feel. I just hope you feel me.
It's crazy because everything that I say is what he said to me over these years. Crazy things like him being in the cell with someone that's been dead for 4 days. Mm. Or him not being able to sleep at night because grown men getting raped in their cell. Grown men crying in their cell, talking about, I want to go home. Him feeling like I didn't pick the streets over you, bruh, but that was my only option. I didn't have it like you. Like, you know, your mom sheltered you. And dad was at an age where dad was slowing down when you came around. Mm. So, you know, it's a vibrant song, and it comes from a very deep place in my heart, because I speak of truth. I speak of a true scenario in a story. That's the reality, and the reality of it is my brother's incarcerated for the rest of his life.
Yeah.
And we have to deal with that. We have to deal with those situations. So
what I know, like the level of vulnerability, man, just to make a song like that, because when you guys hear the song, it's not just your brother speaking to you, but it's also you responding to those letters in form of a song.
Right.
Like, was it difficult for you to be that vulnerable, not only about your own feelings, but also about family business, really?
It was, in a sense, but I felt like I couldn't tell him. Like I say, I wrote several letters. I just didn't have the courage to send them. Like, I say that on the song. He would write me certain things as a youth, and I would write, but I would never send it. Because I was like, man, this is my big brother. He going to beat my ass when I get out if I ever say something like this. So those were certain things that I finally just said, let me say what it is that I feel. And then I played it for my other brother, and he just looked at me, and he was like, damn, bro. He was like, and I've been feeling like that about big bro, too. It's just, it's crazy. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you said it. Like, I couldn't have said it. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I was able to address what we felt as little brothers. Like, you know what I'm saying? As little brothers, like, how we felt we were abandoned. How we felt, like, you know, when you would see other people in their relationships with their brothers, and people always talk about their big brothers, and we would always just say, well, our brother in jail, he about to get out. And then when he finally got out, he wasn't ready to be out. So he was still institutionalized. And that mentality is what later led to him being sentenced to jail for the rest of his life.
Yeah.
And it's just a hard situation to talk about, man. But that's what makes the music dope, man, because I really gave you a story and a scenario of sibling rivalry that resonates with several people.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's the song is going to help a lot of people, man, who are dealing with family members, whether it be a brother, it could be a mother, father, son, daughter, whoever that's incarcerated. Because as you said, like when certain people are institutionalized, they feel like the world is against them, even family. And just to be able to express it and say the tough things that a lot of people aren't willing to say or they don't even know how to articulate, I think that's going to help a lot of families, man, that are going through a similar situation.
Sure.
Yeah, another joint you got on there, man, and the one that I think a lot of people got excited about when it was leaked out there to press early was the Survive joint, man, and that you pulled together and with, you know, straight spitters on there, but not on no rappity rap shit, but on some for real, like real life stuff, man. How did that song come about?
Now remind us who the song, well, who you did the song with, though.
The record is featuring Kendrick Lamar and Crooked Eye, arguably and possibly two of the best spitters to ever come from the West Coast.
For sure.
One from Dr. Dre's camp, one from Eminem's camp, and this, the weirdness of them never doing a song together,
yeah,
up until now, was crazy. So when Kendrick did the record, and I got the record, and I was like, I want to put Crooked on this record because I felt like I want to put those two guys together because those are two of the guys that I respect the most lyrically, not just from the West Coast, but in the game in general. And I called Crooked, and I was like, yo, I got this record for you. He's like, yo, that's what's up. No, actually, me and Crooked was over. Me and Crooked was in Sweden, and I'm like, "Yo, when I get back, I want to send you this record I got." And he was like, "Yo, where are you?" He's like, "For sure." You know, we did a couple records before, and he's like, "Who on a joint?" I'm like, "It's me and Kendrick." He was like, "What?" Like, and his eyes lit up. Like, ooh, I get a chance to show the world that I'm really like, yeah, I was Kendrick before Kendrick,
right?
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it was that look, and we got back and I sent him the record and like he murdered it, bro.
He really
like,
did.
Crooked came so crazy on that record.
The business. You ever been a victim of being a prisoner inside your own mind? The bright lights of the street lights will make you go blind. Handicap your senses. You were just an apprentice of watching niggas jump fences. Now you win the Olympics and your hurdle was high enough to clear the tallest of clotheslines. Talented when they closing in on your behind. Life of a young delinquent, even stole him a Lincoln at 15. Middle fingers walked out the precinct. I mean, the cycle just continue. The vital information in fine print on the menu, so you'll never read it. Even if a nigga lend you money out my own pocket to make it right, you still attend to. Be on them corners with stop signs and a nine, cause 9 times out of 10 Mac-11s cry and 12 died yesterday. And if anyone divide, the 6 that carried you eventually lose their lives. True story.
Across the train tracks where angry and insane blacks they slang crack. Candles burn where they were slain at, and bottles get poured where they would hang at. Close, I give you truth in its essence. Dead homies added to swears when truth is in question. Like, man, I think he lying, or he put that on someone. If I known you 10 years, got the right to say we cousins. I'm from the city of broken homes, and often I was home alone. And mama started smoking, cause daddy was scared to smoke alone. Section 8 policies, top ramen and sunflower seeds. June got killed cause he didn't wanna lose his wallabies. Constant atrocities, knowing it's safe. There's no religion that can save you, say goodbye to your faith. Whether you Muslim or a Christian, Baptist, Jewish, or Adventist, atheist, or not religious, put survival on your wish list, cause
nightfall.
In a
apartment and saw your father on the carpet with a belt wrapped around his arm and a scarf under his armpit and a needle shoved in his bicep. Earlier this morning, you warned him his addict habits is something you couldn't digest. You cried saying, I just don't want to see you die. Now you're trying to dissect the fact that he hasn't opened his eyes yet. You collapsed on his body and you started thinking, I could perform CPR and jumpstart his heart if it's beating. But his pulse started to weaken, his cardio region depleting as you give him part of your breathing. He dead and gone, and you had a bad feeling when you was heading home. Now it's etched in stone, you've been left alone. So you grabbed his chrome gun, handle all pearl. Oh no, girl, put it to your head, thinking fuck everybody like a call girl in a small world. Then pull back, but it didn't clap. Damn.
Crooked came so crazy on that record.
Yeah, that was...
He came so crazy on that record. That record was pure fire.
Definitely, man. Also, I gotta say, man, you already know, because I've been in the middle of this thing forever, so you don't know how happy I was to see you and Vine put y'all differences aside and sit down on the radio, because people don't... If you be out, you know. Like, I went on New Year's Eve when I was home... And I came through the little after hours spot. Vine came downstairs and got me. It was like, yo, Fab in here too. And then I ran into you and we all chopped it up and shit.
Now, BP, you're getting too Oakland centric for folks that are not from the Bay. You gotta explain who and what a Vaughn is.
Okay, well, Big Vaughn is a radio guy in the Bay Area, KML. So he would be what Greg Street is in Atlanta. With, you know, whoever your guy is, your hip hop guy who's been on the station forever in your city, you know, enough envy, whoever, you know, Vaughn is that guy out in the Bay Area. And Vaughn and my guy Fab had issues once upon a time. So it was good to see
you. Yeah, we went on a 10-year hiatus of everything with each other, man. So for us, we recently, man, about a month ago, was able to sit down and finally just put it all in the air and the atmosphere, how we felt about what we felt. And it was dope, man. It was dope to hear his side of the story after all of these years. And he heard, you know, we both voiced our opinion to each other. We both talked about how so many other people were speaking for us and from us, but yeah, we never got a chance to really talk about it ourselves. A couple years ago, we severed the ignorance, he and I, but we had never allowed the rest of the Bay Area, as well as anyone, the onlookers, to see that we had rekindled our the conversation and the level of friendship to open it up back to a communicative point of view. So we were able to do that, man, and it was just dope, man. It's like a breath of fresh air when a lot of people got a chance to see us too, sit down and talk and relive moments that we once did, and hopefully be in position to make new ones for the future. So that was a good thing. Two powerful people coming together to utilize their influence.
Yeah, I absolutely love it, because, you know, I've told both of y'all a million times, both of y'all are assholes, so it only makes perfect sense that y'all can get together and be cool and make some things happen together, man. Another thing, about a little over a year ago, man, we lost one of the most important factors in this industry in the Jacka, and also a really good guy. And you've told me for God knows how long that the Jack was your favorite rapper, period.
Period.
And, you know, you were the person I called immediately when I heard what happened, because, you know, rumors, we've been killing folks we love prematurely for years, well before TMZ. So I didn't want to believe it at all. So you were the first person I called, man. And, you know, you were blessed to be able to, you know, have a joint with him on the album as well, which is dope for people that aren't aware of how much he meant to you and how much he meant to the Bay. And really beyond the Bay, because if you talk to Freeway, he'll tell you, like, he's gone overseas with Jacka before, and the crowd would be more hyped to see Jack than they were to see him, and he was the headliner. You know, Jack had those kind of fans.
I was at those shows.
Yeah, man. So talk
real,
just
we went over there several times with Free, me, Jack, and Free, and we, you know, in England and Malmö, Sweden, and Norway, and things like that. Forever and ever and ever, I always tell people, and I didn't wait, like you say, man, until something happened to the brother Shahid, man. But I always told the world that Jacka was my favorite rapper.
Yeah.
Always. He was always, like, you know what I'm saying, it was just something about his music, something about his character, something about his demeanor that I just, I admired and I respected with the utmost respect. And, you know, when I heard about what happened, man, I was crushed, man. I was destroyed. I probably was one of the first guys on the scene at the hospital. And I know for sure me and PK were the first guys to get the confirmation when the police officer came down and said that he didn't make it.
Right.
So that crushed me, man. That was crazy. It was like losing Mac Dre all over again, but this time it hurt a little bit more because, you know, Dre was a big homie, and me and Dre would, like, you know, we were in the beginning stages of cultivating that friendship, and, you know, he was just already, you know, who he was. Me and Jack kind of, like, came in the ranks together, you know?
Yeah.
We toured the country, toured the world together. Like, we shared a lot of memories, and he would, you know, give me priceless game and advice and certain things in life. And, you know, at all my biggest accomplishments in my career, he was always there. From, you know, me signing, my record release party, me signing to Atlantic, me going on, you know, being in certain events, and, you know, he was always there. When I look back at my major birthday parties, battle raps, every significant event in my career, if you look around in the crowd or you look on stage through portraits, you are going to find the Jack. He was always there. He never missed none of my big events.
Right.
And he was there in all support, man. So, that will always and forever be a tough pill to swallow to me.
I'm sure, most definitely, man. And from a personal level and a peer level, I'm sure. This is crazy. Right. So one thing I thought that was super dope getting back to the album is the first Son of a Pimp, which really, like, launched you into that local celebrity and then launched you into a national celebrity with all the joints that were hot off Son of a Pimp 1, but you had your father on the cover of it. And this one, you have Mama Dez on the cover, kind of taking it full circle, which is really dope, man. What does that mean to you to be able to honor your parents in that way?
They'll be forever immortalized through portraits and through this music, man. It'll always be, it's in the history books, you know, it's in the almanacs. So no matter what, they'll live forever through that. If you ever want to go back and you ever want to look it up, that'll always be there.
Definitely.
Be able to do that was a great feeling, man.
Definitely.
For years, nobody knew that was actually my dad on that cover. And then I've been reading, like, certain comments from the blogs and things like that with people like, yo, who was that woman on the cover? She looked like a boss. I'd just be like, you know, for people to just to look at my mom and see her like that, that's dope. Because, you know, that's what she was.
Most definitely, man. And she was always around, dude. Like, during
that run.
Yeah, most definitely. That's dope. So while we're recording this in about 30 minutes, we got game 4, Warriors against the Thunder, man. We ain't talked about this series, bro. What's your thoughts so far?
Steph's going to drop 40 tonight, man. Steph's going 40, man. Harrison Barnes. I had a dream. Harrison Barnes did some amazing things tonight. I had a dream, man. You know, the Oracle came and told me, man, Harrison Barnes is going to go off. He's going to have a game of his life tonight, man.
Okay.
We just have to go play Warriors basketball. I mean, 73 times over, we proved that when we're playing Warriors basketball, nobody can beat us. It's evident. You can't say, I was talking to a troll yesterday, and he was like, yeah, the Warriors were overrated. They were hyped up. And when I say, so we have 73 victories this year. Well, let me guess, we didn't play anybody. So, you know what I'm saying?
You
so,
still talk to the trolls?
Say whatever.
I won't talk to them.
Yeah, I had to talk to him because that was just crazy to me. Like, you could say anything about them. But the Warriors are overrated. Come on, man. 73 victories? Come on, bro. Like, so I just was like, come on, dude. So when we go play real Warriors basketball, not trying to be fancy, not trying to be, you know, pretty. We don't want to emulate Lob City. We don't want to play like Oklahoma City. We want to play Golden State Warriors basketball. 73 times over, we've shown that there's nobody that can beat us out there.
I agree.
What I mean? So we have to go out and go play the basketball that we play. Dash and splash, baby. Dash and splash.
Six or seven?
I say six. I've always said six. I said that they were going to get one at our home, and they're going to get one at their home, and then they won't win anymore.
Okay.
But if it goes seven, hey, as long as it doesn't go five.
I'm with you 100% on that, bro. So, man, it's been a long time coming, man. Before we go, how does it feel, bro? You on the cusp of bringing out this album. You getting Rolling Stone done said, what if the three tracks that they heard are indicative of the entire album, then it'll be album of the year candidate, man. It's you getting a lot of accolades, bro. How does it feel?
And that's crazy, man, just to hear them say that after three songs. And then I gave a copy to a friend of mine who's on the board of the Grammys, and he was like, dude, I'm really, like, going for this record to be nominated for a Grammy. He was like, that's because, like, I played it in the office amongst my peers, and I've never seen the reaction from someone that they've never heard of.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? So to hear people say the who's, the whys, and where's, and how am I not informed on who this guy is humbling to me. Like I say, I don't care if this record does a miraculous amount of numbers. What I want and what I hope for is that those who actually respect the artistry and the true form of art and hip-hop rate this at a high place in their hearts, because it's such a rarity in today's industry that people are making music like this. I don't take any cadences. I don't take any, you know, any. I don't sound like anything that's already out. It doesn't sound like the hottest rapper song right now. You know, I'm not rapping no one else's cadence. I'm not rapping none of that. This is all original stuff, man. And it's the beauty of it is to say, man, y'all got to really feel me on this, man. This is crazy. So I'm just happy to be able to put out a project that's as an individuality, it shows my staying power, and it shows how 10 years, 11 years later, the relevancy is still there, because it was always based off originality, and it was always based off a promising place that was honesty. You come from the land of honesty, you'll always be able to, you know, be around.
For sure.
It was true. I never fabricated in my music. I never lied about anything. I didn't hit them with the now and later raps. I hit them with all. This is what I'm going through. I've let the world see me in my lowest form. I've let them see me take losses. I've taken losses publicly and behind the scenes, but I've never been ashamed of them, nor did I ever back down from the losses that I've taken. I've made bad decisions. I've done everything that, you know, one can do that would be the defamation and the declaration of their destroying. But I'm still here. I'm still building. And I'm still motivated, I'm still ambitious, I'm still hungry, and above it all, I'm still very talented and capable to make great music that resonates through all worlds and all walks of life. And that's the beauty about this project. So Friday, hopefully those that listen to it can understand my feeling and relate to me. And whatever happens, happens.
For sure, for sure. One more thing, bro, before we go. I gotta ask you, what's up with the 30th anniversary short album?
Now, for everybody that does not know, Fab has pretty much been like the executive producer of what's supposed to be Too Short's final album for real this time. He's not going to pull the Getting It album number 10 stunt. This is actually going to be the final one.
I mean, you got to think he's much different than that album, man. He's 50 years old now.
Yeah.
At 50 years old, he doesn't want to do no more studio albums. Sad moment the other day, his mother just passed on Mother's Day.
Oh, damn.
So he's like really been going through like, you know, just some life changing things for him. And it's crazy for him to kind of, you know, to have to experience this. And it's like, wow, it's like just crazy to see Short in this emotional predicament, because I've never seen him show emotion. Like, right. He's always just been the cool guy. I've never seen him get mad. I've never seen him, you know, I've never seen any emotion like that from him. It's always just been cool ass Short. So to see this and, you know, to have him come, you know, come to me and open up to me the way that he has, it definitely shows me that he wants to do something to keep him busy, to keep his mind off of that. So he's, the project is called 3 Decades a Game, the 30th anniversary. I was in position to write an A&R, the whole project. Kind of did similar to what I did with my project. I went and reached out to all his friends and people who have been influenced and inspired by Too Short amongst their whole career. So it's star-studded all the way out through in. And I think he's going to leak a record maybe next month.
Okay.
We go down. When I leave New York, I'm going to fly to L.A., and we're going to talk about what record we're going to leak. If it's anything that I want to have something to do with, I'm probably going to leak the Ty Dolla, French Montana, and Jeremiah record, which is crazy. It's straight, traditional Short, and it's a great lead off to the trajectory of where we want to go with this project, to give back that vintage Short, that Too Short that we all grew up loving. Like, wow, it's crazy. So it's some dopeness, man, and we got him back in rare form of him sounding like the Born and Mac Short, man.
You yeah.
know what I'm saying? The cuss word Short.
So, that's what we want to hear. That's what we want to hear. Well, y'all, appreciate you hollering at me, man, and good luck on everything. I will definitely be I still buy hard copy, so I'm going to pre-order the album on Amazon, get it sent to the crib.
Yes, Lord.
And we appreciate it, bro. Be safe out there in New York, man.
Thank you guys, man. Y'all always been supportive in everything in my career, man. And I'm just very appreciative that these many years later, we still, you know, connected and tight, man. You know, B, we brothers. This is beyond journalism and music with us. So I'm thankful, man. And MG, man, I appreciate you too, brother.
For sure.
For sure, man. All right,
yes,
bro.
Yes, sir.
Peace.
Yes, sir.
What up, world? It's Rich Medina. You are now in tune to Day One Radio.
And we're back, man. Hopefully y'all enjoyed that interview. And go make sure you pick up Son of a Pimp 2, available on iTunes and Amazon and everywhere else. On that's tomorrow, May 27th.
That's right.
You know, once y'all hear this, that's tomorrow. And we got to...
And make sure y'all buy it, man. I mean, I'm pretty sure Fab is going to appreciate any support, man. But let's buy this man's album, man. Like, no more streaming records, man. No more, you know what I'm saying...
yeah, man.
Everybody gets a trophy out here.
I'm not that. I'm pretty good with counting, but I ain't that. I can't even count this streaming Billboard stuff, bro. Like, I can't even figure it out, man. I still buy albums,
right?
For the albums that I want to support, and I'd definitely be buying that one. Also, man, it's Memorial Day weekend coming up. You know, it's in Atlanta. We got Jazz Fest popping off. All Vinyl Everything popping off. All kind of stuff in the Bay. I know the homie Rod got Cool Water jumping off, which is always a dope event. And everywhere you go, it's going to be something going on. But make sure you drink responsibly. Don't drink and drive. Go ahead and use that Uber. It ain't nothing but a little 2 or 3 seconds on your phone. Call a Uber. Save you about 5-10 racks, man. Don't nobody want a DUI. You definitely don't want to hurt yourself or hurt nobody else. Insurance go up. All of that, man. Make sure y'all are responsible. have a good time. Ladies, bring them sundresses out. Fellas, dust off the white kicks, and let's have a good time. And we'll see y'all next week with another dope show.
Inside them project building, they blowing them cookies, that's all the ghetto children. Plotting on ways that we can make a million, million, Lord. But up until then,
go.
But up until then,
let's get it.
Let's say I'm in a room with a bitch, and I hold on wanna fuck like a man, I'ma be my me. Then get my fucking nut for sure. That's just how we do it in the hood, bruh. Oh, 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 what? You ain't know, bruh, yeah. That's that old school Jew, bruh. I used to slap that shit every day at school, bruh. Brought that shit back now, that old slap sound new, bruh. Rack after stacks, I got pool, bruh. Rich nigga, but I'm still in the jets, bruh. Candy paint, got the whip looking wet, bruh. Ooh, I'm shining, bruh. And like my nephew, Young Pharaoh, big timing, bruh. And if them suckers outside, then we sliding, bruh. I swear to God, man, them niggas in hiding, bruh. And we ain't wasting no shots on civilians, bruh. Too busy plotting on ways to make a million, bruh.
I'ma be thugging inside them project building. They blowing them cookies, that's all the ghetto children. Plotting on ways that we can make a million, million.
Whoa,
yeah.
I be grinding, scraping, rental riding. I act broke, you act rich, we both lying. I be grinding, scraping, rental riding. I act broke, you act rich, we both lying.
Duck in the pen to get a break. Helping all the project children have faith. One shot for the kids doing bids where I stay. One shot for the niggas doing bids in the bay. If we pray, we gon' make it, but God, he seen busy. Till then, we got hoes for pounds and plenty chicken. Damn, we was poor as a kid, I'm reminiscing. Still a nigga draws in while I had to get him. Shit, I know the feeling when your brother in jail and your dad in cold and your sister hoe. Shit, don't give up, though, you gon' make it. Remember when the ghetto child making people hate it. Remember money easy to get, but hard to say. Remember when pain come in your life, gotta take it. I know you lose hope when you're looking at your mama, the drama, but you can be Obama.
But up until then, I'ma be thugging inside them project building. They blowing them cookies, that's all the ghetto children. Plotting on ways that we can make a million, million.
Whoa, yeah.
But up until then,
I be grinding, scraping, rental riding. I act broke, you act rich, we both lying. I be grinding, scraping, rental riding. I act broke, you act rich, we both lying.
You getting money, bruh? Acting funny, bruh? Like Mac Drake, they don't ever hear your tummy, bruh. They say Fab, bring the movement back. Dope, air big, bruh, what you gonna do with that? You in the hood, bruh? Is it good, bruh? 45th, same corner where you stood, bruh. Oh, you a G, bruh, just like me, bruh. Heard you selling tree from an ape to a P, bruh. Getting stacks, bruh, like that, bruh. Your name ain't never came on that rap facts, bruh. Oh, you solid, bruh, got a couple dollars, bruh. Did your time, you ain't tail on your partners, bruh. Getting money, bruh, staying under, bruh. About to bring out your trophies for the summer, bruh. They think they know, but they don't know, just make them wonder, bruh. You doing your thing, little nigga, boy, you coming up.
I'ma be thugging inside them project building. They blowing them cookies, that's all the ghetto children. Plotting on ways that we can make a million, million.
Whoa, yeah. I be grinding, scraping, rental riding. I act broke, you act rich, we both lying. I be grinding, scraping, rental riding. I act broke, you act rich, we both lying.